Good morning, guys.
Good morning, everyone.
I'm Jono.
I'm Corey.
And welcome to Bridge Church Online. If you are tuning in, we are in the fifth week of our series on mental health and well-being, and Reverend Andy Buttress will be coming in later with a talk on shame. Make sure you stick around to watch it.
Absolutely. If you have been watching up until now, you might have heard of our Alpha course, which we are starting tomorrow. So today is your great opportunity to get signed up so you don't miss the first session. You can do that through our website or find a link on our Facebook page. Alpha is a really great opportunity if you've got some questions about faith, if you've got some faith, none at all, or it's really good for inviting friends along too as well. Check out this video.
If you've ever wondered if there's more, you're not alone in that. We all explore, every day, in small ways and big. We find ourselves, reinvent ourselves, define ourselves, publish our lives. We find ways to stand out and ways to blend in. We meet people that remind us of us, and people that remind us of who we want to be, and people that just make the journey that much more fun. We connect and share. We learn from each other and grow together. We celebrate and mourn side by side. We push our limits, challenge ourselves, fall down and get back up again. Our days are long and our nights get short. We put in the hours in the hope of building something that lasts. And at the end of the day, find joy in the fleeting things. We want to squeeze all the life out of life and hit pause on moments we wish could last. Put simply, we want to live, and along the way, discover all we can, experience more, and find out who we really are. For all our searching, it's rare to find time to think and talk about the big questions of life, about faith and reason and God and meaning. But exploring is good. We're built for it.
If that's something you're interested in, make sure you get involved. Sign up on the website or find more information on our Facebook page.
Absolutely. Now, you'll have figured out by now that our series is on mental health and well-being, and the talk in a little while is going to be focusing on the really tricky subject of shame. Linked to mental health and well-being, we are very fortunate this morning to have a two-part interview with a lovely lady called Donna. She has taken some time to speak to our leader of Bridge Church, Andy Buttress, to firstly explain a little bit about her life story, and then to go on to talk specifically about mental health. So now we are going to watch the first part of Donna's interview.
So Donna, thank you for joining us this morning. Lovely to see you. Okay, I don't know too much about you. Can you just talk a little bit about your life? Some of the key moments in your life, maybe?
Okay, so my name's Donna and I'm 54 and I moved to Ipswich about 3 years ago. Prior to that, I lived for many, many years in Godalming in Surrey. I think I'm a bit of a traveller because I was born in Birmingham and then I moved to Dorset with my family. And then I had quite a difficult upbringing. And so the minute I was about 18, I'd finished my A-levels and I just headed off as fast as I could to get away from my family. So I lived in quite a lot of different places. But when I was about 30, I had my first child, and that was in Godalming in Surrey. And that's where I settled down and made a home there for many, many years until I moved here. My job brought me here to Ipswich. I spent my early career as a community and youth worker. So I got my degree in community and youth studies at Lancaster. And then literally within the year of qualifying as a community and youth worker, I saw a job in the NHS for an HIV training and development officer with young people. And so youth and health sort of merged together. And then I spent 23 years in various jobs in the NHS.
That's a really good potted history of yourself. Thank you. What about your faith? Have you always been a Christian, would you say?
I was baptized a Catholic. I have to say this by a very drunk Irishman. So I was actually baptized Nodda Gibbs, where my name is really Donna Gibbs. So I was baptized, so brought up a Catholic. And it was my experience of going to my particular Catholic churches. They're not all like this, but it was that very much that I went and I had lots of questions that I wasn't able to ask. And as I got older, those questions got bigger. So one of the big questions I had was about the role of women in church. Had real concerns about homosexuality, how gay people were represented. I started to feel that my life and the people I was closest to, we didn't seem to fit with the kind of church that I was going to. And I stayed in the Catholic Church until I was at university. And I had a clash with a priest. It was actually in Liverpool. And he was giving a talk at a remembrance service. And he was talking about God being on our side. And I ended up challenging, saying I couldn't see Jesus standing with a gun. And he said, I don't want to hear your opinions. I don't want to have a discussion with you. Keep your opinions to yourself. So I went for my wilderness period. I left the Catholic Church. I left all forms of religion. But I didn't stop meditating. I don't even know if I go as far as saying it was praying, but I would light candles a lot. I think I did pray, but I absolutely was anti-religion. And then in Godalming, when I had my two daughters, I was married to a man who had children from a previous relationship, and every weekend he went to spend time with them. And one very lonely weekend, I was in the park one Sunday morning, and I just strolled into the first church near the park, and it was an Anglican church. And at that time, I didn't really know the difference between all the different churches. And I felt at home. I was welcomed. It was a bit weird, not what I was used to. So at the end, the vicar came up to me and said, "Do you want a coffee?" And kind of pointed to some room. And I thought, no, thank you very much. And so off I went with my daughters. But he kept offering this. And when I went into this back room, it was a big hall and lots of people were having teas and coffees. And that was an aspect of church I had never experienced, that fellowship. I had been confirmed as a Catholic. So what I didn't do was make a new commitment to Christ in that sense. But what I found, I don't know if I'm jumping around here, Andy, but this is my life story. The best way of describing my faith journey is that I sometimes feel I'm converted nearly every day, because the deeper I start to have a faith, the more I really get a sense that God loves me just as I am, and I don't have to assimilate like the Borg in Star Trek. I don't have to be molded into something I'm not. I can be all me, and yet I can grow in faith.
Fantastic. That's really good. So what I want to do now is just put this on hold, okay? And we're going to come to part two of this interview, okay, very shortly.
Thank you, Donna. It's good to get to know you a bit more. And we look forward to delving a bit deeper into mental health and well-being with you a bit later on this morning.
We do. But for now, it's time to go over to Andy for our message this morning. And as I've already mentioned, it's about the subject of shame. This talk that Andy is about to give us does contain some quite tricky and sensitive topics, just to let you know. It's so important that we can be real and authentic when we're talking about mental health and well-being. And shame is one of those topics that if we're not real about it, then there's not really much point talking about it. So just to let you know that there might be some things in there that's difficult to hear. But if there is something that comes out that you'd really like to talk to somebody about, then we will give you some details later on who you can talk to. But for now, sit back, grab your cuppa if you have one, and listen to what Andy has to say on the subject of shame.
When I was at primary school, I used to come home for lunch. And one day, I went up the garden where we had chickens. I saw that one of our chickens had laid an egg. So I went to collect the egg and stuck it in my pocket and thought nothing of it. until about 3 o'clock in the afternoon, when I got up from the table and felt this gooey stuff running down my leg. I mean, what do you do when you're 8 and you feel egg down your leg? Well, I think I went to the toilet and tried to kind of sort myself out. And I remember when I came back into the class and they wondered where I'd gone, it was just a little bit embarrassing. Well, today I'm going to speak on the subject of shame. And I want to say, first of all, that shame is not embarrassment. Embarrassment is when you kind of feel foolish or stupid in a social context. But shame is far more than that. Shame is not guilt either. Guilt is when you feel bad for something that you have done. And guilt is rooted in the conscience. But shame is when you feel bad because of who you are. It's rooted in the soul. It's something very deep and inner. So guilt is when you feel guilty because of what you've done, but shame is when you feel bad because of who you actually are. So this morning I want to talk about shame, and I want to look at two true stories which will illustrate both when you feel shame because of what you've done, and when you feel shame because of what has been done to you. So first of all, a story about Max. Now, Max was an alcoholic, and he was in an AA group in America, Alcoholics Anonymous. But he was having trouble admitting that he was an alcoholic. He was quite difficult and belligerent in the group. He wouldn't kind of tell the whole truth. And it was actually quite difficult, although he did admit that there was something deep within him that felt really heavy. So on one occasion, the group leader called Sean was having trouble with Max, who wasn't telling the whole truth. But he did say that something had happened on Christmas Eve. But he wouldn't say what. So in a bold move, Sean rings Max's wife up and asks her what happened on Christmas Eve. And on speakerphone, his wife tells this story. Max was in the car with his daughter, Debbie, and they were going to buy a Christmas present. So they went into town and bought a Christmas present, the pair of shoes that Debbie had always wanted. And they were coming back, and Max was feeling good. It was Christmas Eve. This was going to be a really good Christmas. But he stopped and he said to Debbie that it'll only be a few minutes, because he wanted to go into the Cork and Bottle, his local pub. So he locked the doors, he wound up the windows, he actually left the engine running to keep the car warm because it was incredibly cold outside. And so he went into the Cork and Bottle, and when he went into the Cork and Bottle, he saw a few old army mates there and had a few drinks, and time went on. In fact, it went on till nearly midnight. And when he came out of the pub and went back to the car, worse for wear, the car was all frozen up. The engine had stopped. And when they got in, or when they opened the door, Debbie, the daughter, was frostbitten. They took her to hospital and she had to have a thumb and a finger amputated. And from that day, she had impaired hearing. So imagine this being told to this group with Max in the group. And when the story had finished, Max completely collapsed. He just fell on his knees. He was an absolute wreck. And he sobbed and he wailed. out of a deep sense of shame. Now, that is quite an extreme short story, and the chances are that you haven't got quite a story like that. But nevertheless, we all, from time to time, experience shame in some way. Sometimes we may feel that we have never lived up to our parents' expectations, and we feel bad inside. Sometimes we feel that we have addictive behaviours that make us feel bad. Or maybe it's something sexual. Maybe you've hurt someone in the past, and that kind of makes you feel really bad about yourself. Or maybe you just weren't there when you were supposed to be there. So we feel shame often because of what we have done. It's not just guilt, but there's something more that is going on in the inside that makes us feel bad as a human being. But there is this other type of shame too, which we feel when something has been done to us. When something bad has happened to us, caused by another person or other people. And even though it's not our fault, we still feel bad inside because of that. Let me tell you another story. And this story is from the Old Testament, the first part of the Bible. It's quite a horrendous story. It's certainly not the story that you would hear in Sunday school. But it involves a couple of people called Amnon and Tamar. Now, Amnon is a prince and Tamar is his half-sister. So Amnon, the prince, this young prince, is obsessive about the beautiful Tamar. He is completely besotted by her. And on one occasion, he feigns illness. He pretends to be ill. And so he's lying there in bed and he asks for some food. And he asks that Tamar would bring him some food. So Tamar comes to cook and bring him some food. And when she is there, he grabs her and rapes her. And then the story progresses, because very soon after this, it says in the text that Amnon hated her with an intense hatred. Shortly after this rape, he hates her with an intense hatred, and he desires to get her out of his life. So he arranges for her to be dismissed from the royal household. Nowhere to go but to be dismissed from the royal household and just simply to leave. So you can imagine what's going on in Tamar's heart, what's going on in her life. Anyway, Amnon manages to throw Tamar out, and so she is destitute. She is absolutely desperate. And it says again in the text, in a book called 2 Samuel, it says that Tamar put ashes on her face, tore her beautiful dress, put her hands on her head, and went away weeping aloud. So in this passage, you can see Tamar, this young woman, feeling completely shamed by this event, feeling shame in her heart because she's been raped, because she's been forced out of her family home, and because no doubt the community in which she has lived now thinks she's a slut. Because of who are they going to believe? Well, they're going to believe, aren't they, the prince. So this story of Amnon and Tamar is an illustrative story of shame, of how Tamar feels shame, even though she is not guilty because of what has been done to her. And again, that's a kind of a really extreme example for many of us listening to this. Although when you talk about trafficking and sexual exploitation, there are many people in this world that have similar experiences, which we mustn't forget. But perhaps for the majority of people, shame like this perhaps comes in the form when somebody in our lives, in the past or in the present, has had authority or control over us. Perhaps it's been a family member in childhood who's been very dominant, been very critical, emotionally abusive perhaps, and has caused us to feel really bad about ourselves as a person. You may even have a school teacher who had the gift, the ability to make you feel really bad when you failed or whatever the situation was. And I can think of a few incidences there, to be honest. Or maybe you're currently in a work situation and you have a difficult boss or a difficult manager, and they sometimes make you feel bad. It's kind of like a shame and blame thing that's going on. And I don't know what your situation is and whether you've ever felt shame because of something that was done to you. But it is quite common. And probably in our lives somewhere, we have all felt this sense of shame. So how do we deal with this sense of shame? Well, here are a few pointers. First of all, if it is something that you have done, try and sort it out. Try and get right with other people. Do whatever you can to sort it out yourself. What I mean by that is do all you can do to reconcile the situation, ask for forgiveness, forgive others, do what you need to do to try and help. And then when you've done all you can do, leave it there. That might not be reciprocated. People might not forgive you, but that's okay. That's not your problem anymore, as long as you have forgiven and tried to do everything you can do. And then draw a line in the sand and be determined to move on without being defined anymore by the past. The second thing, particularly if you have done something that has caused this shame, is to get right with God. Get right with God. God is someone who thinks you're worth it. He wouldn't have sent Jesus to die for you if he didn't think you are worth it. When we feel shame, we don't think we're worth it. So let's get right with God, because that's the way we will be healed, because he thinks you are worth it. Maybe you need to confess to him stuff that you've done, but his heart is to rebuild you and transform you and make you into the person that you was always meant to be. And then the third thing is forgive yourself. We need to forgive ourselves. We need to realize that we all mess up. None of us are perfect. We all have flaws. And we've got the rest of our lives to try and improve and try and become better people with the help of God. But we have to forgive ourselves. And I say, draw that line in the sand and move on. And one of the ways we do that is realize that we're not perfect and we mustn't be perfectionists. We are who we are. Let's move on. And if it's something to do with something that has been done to you, that's really tough and that's really difficult. And there is always a place to seek help and to seek support and to seek counseling. Because sometimes we need to talk these through. We need to be able to work out how we are going to move forwards into the future. But whatever your situation is this morning, I want you to remember that there is always hope. However bad we may feel at the moment, there is always hope. However tough things are at the moment, there is always hope. You see, for Max, the alcoholic, there was always hope. And he found his hope eventually in a new faith in God. And believe it or not, Tamar, this woman who was completely done to, you know, raped, thrown out of home, vilified, she did marry. And she had children later on. And she is part of Jesus' family tree that you can read about in another part of the Bible. And it is Jesus who gives us this hope. You see, when he came, he told the people why he came. It's his mandate. He said, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor," and that's poor in spirit as well as poor poverty-wise, "proclaim freedom for those who are captive, recovery of sight for the blind, and healing for those who have been crushed." The brokenhearted, those who have crumbled in spirit. That's why Jesus came, to restore people who feel shame. He takes away our shame, and by his Spirit, he begins to refortify us and create us, recreate us into the people we were meant to be. Not people who feel bad about ourselves, but people who feel good about ourselves. Because we are now aware that we are in touch with a loving God who thinks we're worth it, who created us in his image. So, shame. We all feel it from time to time. Don't let it define you, but let Jesus change you. Amen.
Thanks, Andy. A really powerful message, and some things in there that were quite difficult to hear. If any of that has particularly spoken to you, please do not hesitate to get in touch. You will see an email address come up on your screen. This is the email address of a lovely lady who is in charge of the pastoral care in our church. We'd love you to get into contact with her, and she will respond to you this week. If there's anything at all in the service today, or indeed in previous services, and you need to talk to someone about it, particularly if you feel that you fall into the second category that Andy was talking about, when something's been done to you and that's causing feelings of shame, please make sure that you do reach out to somebody this week.
Such a real message, right? It's crazy. So thank you, Andy. Now, we're going back to the second part of Donna's interview, where she shares some of her experience with mental health and well-being and the importance of reaching out. Here it is.
So as you know, Donna, we're in the church doing this series on mental health and well-being. Has your life sort of ever crossed, you know, that path of mental health and well-being? Has it ever touched upon it?
If you'd asked me that question 15 years ago, I would have said, not me, but members of my family. So my dad is an alcoholic. He's an alcoholic in denial. So very clear that he doesn't go for many, many hours of the day without a drink. And that deeply impacted on my childhood. I had quite an aggressive, scary childhood. But it never entered my head that any of that might have impacted on my mental health. For me, when I grew up, mental health was a dirty word. We had lots of stereotypes about people with mental health problems. And I became very successful in what I did in my life. So my outside was looking very functional, very successful. But what was happening on the inside was I was full of fear and doubt. I drank too much myself. I felt that I had started to drink a lot to manage myself. I went through many, many years where I would wake up first thing in the morning with a knot in my stomach. And I learned to work around that knot. I didn't know what it was. I now realize that's anxiety. I never talked to a soul about it. I just got on with my life. And I had quite a serious physical health condition. I had crumbling discs and I had some gynae problems. So I became quite involved in going to the GP and had to have some operations. And I was given quite a period of time of convalescing. I was off work. And during that time, living with myself without the mask, without having to drag myself into work and then put on the mask, without having the identity of being needed at work. By then I was a director in the NHS. So I'd got this month or so off and I kind of fell apart. And it was only my family. I was a single mum at that point, and it was only my family who were really seeing the falling apart. And I was very lucky that I started to talk to some people in church about what was going on for me. And I was terrified that they would tell someone, or I was terrified that they would label me as a nutter or something like that. But I found that the more I shared, and there were lots of tears, lots of distress, but the more I shared with trusting people, the more I had a sense of God bringing to me resources. It was like, so one of my wonderful phrases now, I have lots of mantras and phrases that keep me going in life. And one of mine is share to get well. So I did share, and I ended up going and having some time with a psychotherapist. And it turned out that I don't know if you can see with the camera, but I'm scalded. I have scars on my body. And it was a teapot. And it turns out that I'd never really got to the bottom of how this accident had happened, but it had happened through me being left alone, and I'd poured a teapot of boiling water over me. I was then rushed to hospital, but I ended up, because of the nature of alcoholism in my family, I ended up being in hospital, taken by a stranger, and I was alone in hospital, and I was 1.5 years old. And so through psychotherapy, I've been able to be healed of these things. And so for me, mental health, what I have learned is that the best way that I try and support anyone with any mental health issues is to definitely encourage them to just share their story and know that I will listen. I won't say that they're stupid or it's irrelevant or laugh at them, whatever it is, it doesn't need a diagnosis. But the other is that if you do need to go for professional help, whether it's professional mental help or spiritual help, I actually personally believe it all gets wrapped in together, that the emphasis is on my healing rather than focusing on what other people think or feel. And I don't think I've said that very well, but it's really important that for me, the reason I feel I have healed some of my problems is because someone took the time to say, this is all about you. We're going to focus on how you felt. Where I think so often people try and talk about maybe, well, who's wronged you and let's fix that.
That's fantastic, yeah. And I know, Donna, that even though you had big issues with a Catholic priest many years ago, you yourself are now an Anglican priest and about to embark on a new venture in London. Is that right?
Yeah. So I've been appointed as a pioneer team vicar for North Lambeth Parish. It got announced last week, so I'm very excited.
Congratulations. Yeah.
Yeah. And what it means is I can be the flexible, quirky woman of faith that I am. And I just want to be working with people, and rather than going up to people and be saying, let me tell you about Jesus, I want to be able to do the opposite, actually, is be saying, will you tell me about you? Tell me who you are, and can we come alongside? Yeah. And through that, I'm hoping that people will start to get excited about any stirrings of faith that they have within them.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, thank you. Thank you for your honesty. We've already dealt with honesty in this series. You've been really honest. And thank you for sharing some of your life, Donna, today. God bless you in the future. All the best. Take care.
God bless.
God bless.
Thank you so much, Donna. Thank you for being honest and real with us and taking the time to tell us your story and such an important message about reaching out. We wish you all the best in your future endeavours.
Absolutely. So, did you know, on the website of Mental Health Foundation, they've got a whole page dedicated to pets.
Interesting.
Why pets, you say? Well, pets have been shown to have so many positive benefits, particularly when reducing some impacts of depression, anxiety, loneliness. Mm. So we decided to catch up with some of Bridge Church's pets this week.
Boogie, boogie, boogie.
cute.
Absolutely. I don't know about you, but I really want a dog now.
I know you do. And also, speaking of people that want dogs, my nan and granddad have been tempted to get a dog for such a long while now. So here's a shout out to Tony and Betty Buttress. You know you want a dog, go get one. There's no better reason than this, surely.
I mean, it's on the website, a whole page.
Exactly.
Well, guys, look, sadly, that wraps us up for this week. We hope you've enjoyed it. Thank you for being with us. If you'd like to delve a bit deeper now, you can join us in our Zoom call, where we'll do some prayer, some meditation, and some worship together.
Yes, indeed. If you'd like to join us in Zoom, the login details will be posted in the comments below in just a moment. Don't forget, if you want to be part of Alpha, which starts tomorrow, sign up via the website or find the link on our Facebook page. Make sure you are following the Facebook page and Instagram as well to keep up to date with everything that we're doing here at Bridge Church. And have an absolutely fantastic week.
Have a great week and see you next week, guys.
Bye.